Well, welcome everybody. Tonight's part three of A Brief History of Sacred Music in the Catholic Church. Tonight we're going to talk about the Reformation, hymns, the virtuoso, the symphony, and the opera. Presenters tonight, James Cavanagh, a ChantWorks liturgy specialist, and I'm Diana Silva, ChantWorks music director. And here we are, ChantWorks. I just want to tell you that our website is live. chantworks.com. It's not complete. Not all the links work. We're still working on that madly, but I want to tell you that part one is up on the website under webinars. And James, go ahead.
Yeah, good evening, everybody, and welcome back for our third installment of A Brief Overview of Sacred Music in the Western Church. I hope those of you who participated in the first two sessions have been enjoying it. So this is a wonderful program. ChantWorks is really devoted to recovering and restoring the wonderful sacred treasury that is ours in the Catholic Church, but has largely been lost over the last several decades. And so our mission as ChantWorks is to recover this sacred music, and not just for idle curiosity, but to actually promote it in the parishes and to really assist parishes in developing their scholas so that they can sing the music of the church that has been ours since the very beginning. And so with this overview of musical history, we hope that you'll be able to put Catholic music, sacred music, into its proper context.
And before we go on, just a little bit of housekeeping like we always do. First of all, tonight's webinar is being recorded, but because it's a webinar, not a meeting, no one will be able to see you or hear you. We will have Q&A at the end, so hold your questions till the end, please. If you have a technical issue, please, in the chat, talk to Mike Silva. So last week's quiz at the end was, who is this American resident and son of a more famous composer? And here you see it's Charles Theodore Pachelbel, son of Johann Pachelbel, of his famous, infamous, ubiquitous canon in D. And Charles, we'll hear more about his music later. So tonight we're going to start off talking about the Reformation, and it's not just Martin Luther, it's a few other people that are involved. We've got Zwingli, and we've got Calvin, and other people too. But James, you want to start off a little bit?
Yeah, I want to put this a little bit in a little bit larger context of what's happening in Europe during this period of time. You know, we have the Renaissance that really promotes this idea of humanism and recovering a lot of the lost culture and wisdom of the classical period. And so the rebirth, which is what Renaissance means, the rebirth of Europe, starting in Italy, really begins this ferment throughout Europe of people really appreciating the wisdom of the ancients and how that can really foster human flourishing in their own time. And so a much more positive optimistic assessment of what human beings are capable of. And so that sort of blends the little bit of the background of behind the Reformation that causes the reformers such as Martin Luther to rebel against the church and her doctrines. In fact, as we mentioned last week, the Council of Trent largely was called to refute the false doctrines that the Protestants were promoting. And so a lot of the movement, the intellectual movement at this time, was really to call into question A, the authority of the church, and B, her doctrines.
So how this affected our music? Well, they wanted to have hymns in the vernacular, and Martin Luther wrote a hymn himself. We had other people writing hymns. Well, Zwingli started his own movement. He used to be a Catholic priest. He didn't want any music in his liturgies, but by the end of the century, they did have some music. The problem is, as you see, Martin Luther posted his 95 Theses in 1517. The printing press had only been in existence for a little over 60 years now, and most of the general population couldn't read. Why would they be able to read? They couldn't afford books. But as books got cheaper because of the printing press, more and more we see people starting to sing in church because they start printing hymnals. And we had Calvin, who supervised the writing of the Genevan Psalter, which he wanted people to be able to learn the psalm tones, the psalms, with catchy tunes. He wanted people walking out of church singing these tunes. So one of Martin Luther's hymns that he wrote was A Mighty Fortress, Ein Feste Burg, and you've probably heard it. It sounds kind of like this. Really what it sounded like by the time we got another 100, 150, 200 years later. That's not what it sounded like when he wrote it, because that's not a real catchy tune, is it? You wouldn't walk out of church singing that, would you? This is what it sounded like originally. One of the hymns that you might know from the Genevan Psalter sounds like this. You might recognize this. We know it as Father, we thank thee who hast planted. I won't play all of it. Quite a few hymns that are still in Catholic hymns. If you recognize it, great. If you don't, well, go look it up. Father, we thank thee who has planted. We're moving along to the beginning of the Baroque period in Italy. Remember I said that in England they were still messing around with viols and recorders and kind of Renaissance-y music. It was still developing and getting more complex. In Italy now, though, we've moved into the Baroque. Claudio Monteverdi is seen as the beginning of this. So the Baroque period goes from roughly 1600 to the death of Bach in 1750. Baroque music is sort of like Baroque art. It's very ornate. There are special rules for how to ornament, and ornamentation itself is an improvisatory art. When you have repeats in a piece, that's when you're expected to ornament. It's not supposed to sound the same as it did the first time. You ornament your phrases, you ornament the endings of the phrases, all kinds of different rules. And in Monteverdi's time, they had rules for ornamentation that changed as the Baroque period went on. Now in the Baroque period, we have more of a melody with accompaniment. So in the Renaissance, we had polyphony with individual independent lines that interweaved. Now we have a melody that's the most important, right? Kind of. With a bass line. And usually in Baroque music, you'll hear a walking bass line that sounds often like this. And right here, you'll hear some chant over this. Mm-hmm. now we're talking about harmony in the Baroque period. So in the Renaissance, when you had multiple voices interweaving, if you were to stop it at one point and just play that one note that everybody had at the same time, you might hear a chord. But that's because we live now and we know the music of the Baroque period and since then. We know the music of the Beatles. We know a lot more. Our ears are more developed, or they're just more exposed to this kind of music. But in the Baroque period now, they're starting to actually realize that that moment in time is a chord. And so they're talking about harmony and how harmony is developed, how it's played. The bass line is very important. In Baroque music, the bass line is almost as important as the melody line. And sometimes there's also polyphony, where the melody, there are several melodies happening at once. And they also have imitation, which grows to the writing of the fugue. It's, that's the pinnacle of the Baroque, and Bach is the king there. So we have Claudio Monteverdi, and he worked at St. Mark's in Venice. There's that gorgeous picture of St. Mark's in Venice. And if I had to go to a desert island or Mars, say, to a new community there, and I could only bring one piece of music to describe what Western music was all about, I would bring a piece by Monteverdi, because Monteverdi was at the very cusp of the Baroque, where the Renaissance was ending, the Baroque was beginning. This is the dawn of the opera. So now we have chant, we have imitative writing, we have harmony, we have an orchestra, we have the bass line, we have the virtuoso singer. We've got it all. And Monteverdi wrote his Marian Vespers of 1610. And if I had to take one piece, it would be this piece. And here is a piece from that. And Monteverdi's Vespers, you'll hear everything in here. This is kind of a salad. You'll hear the bass line, you'll hear the chant, you'll hear the polyphony, you'll hear the chords, you'll hear the orchestra, and you'll hear the virtuoso singers. Oops, sorry. This is Laudate Pueri. It is Psalm 112, praise the Lord, all ye children. Praise ye the name of the Lord. I'm gonna start that over.
Thank you.
hear those dance rhythms sneaking in the door. And we got chant. I've been lucky enough to play that piece 3 times. I've never sung it, only played it in the orchestra. That's plenty of fun. Well, one of the things that Monteverdi did, which happens in his Vespers, but I don't know if it was in that piece, but in St. Mark's, there are lots of different lofts all over the place. And so the concept of a split choir was developed. It was happening a little bit in the Renaissance, but it really grew here, and it was called Cori Spezzati, which means split choir. And when we talk about Charles Theodore Pachelbel and his Magnificat, I just wanted to play you that because that is inspired by this kind of writing where you have the double choir. So we got one choir in one place and one choir in the other, not in this piece, but you would hear pieces like this. So here is Pachelbel's Magnificat, double choir. Magnificat, 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 magnificat,
Vengeance, potentials, potentials.
Peace just makes me happy. I hope it makes you happy too. Take it away, James.
Yeah, this period that we're now entering into, called the Age of Reason or the Age of Enlightenment, in which human reason is dominant, and the confidence in the use of human reason to perfect human nature and to perfect human society. And also during this period of time, we have the development of the scientific method. So it's a time of great intellectual confidence in what human beings are capable of doing. Also during this period of time, a little wider view, is the age of discovery. You know, this period began with this slide presentation in the late 15th century, which is about the time the New World was discovered. But European nations were sending ships all over the world in discovering new lands, acquiring new wisdom, experiencing new cultures. And so human wisdom and knowledge was expanding on all fronts. And I think that's kind of reflected in some of this music that we've been hearing, which is, you know, very jubilant, very optimistic, very expansive, and music that really appeals to the intellect, much in keeping with this age of reason.
Thank you, James. Well, moving along, so in the Catholic Church now, we still had chant in local parishes and maybe some polyphony in parishes where they could afford to have a choir and a director. I think in a lot of parishes, though, they probably just had a low mass. And one of the things that developed out of this low mass was something called the organ mass. And instead of singing the parts of the mass, the ordinary, the Kyrie, the Gloria, they didn't play the Creed, but they would play also the Sanctus and the Agnus Dei and the elevation during the Eucharistic prayer. So Francois Couperin wrote a lot of keyboard music. He wrote some masses, a few masses, especially for a midnight mass. He wrote that one, beautiful piece. And he wrote quite a few organ masses, and I want to play that. This is a piece by him for the elevation, and I want to show you, this is the organ at Nantes, I'm not sure how to pronounce it, N-A-N-T-E-S, the cathedral that just burned this last weekend, and the organ was destroyed. This is it. You'll never see it again. And this piece is played on an organ that was built by the same builder as this. I'm not sure if it's the exact same organ or if it's just one built by the same guy. And that was François-Henri Clicquot, who lived from 1732 to 1790. So this piece would be played at the Elevation. Lots of frills. Well, we can't talk about the Baroque period without talking about Johann Sebastian Bach. He was really the culmination of the Baroque period in music. Although he worked in a Lutheran church, he wrote a lot of music, instrumental music. He wrote a lot of cantatas, both secular and sacred. Sometimes, or at least once that I know of, he just changed the words of a secular cantata and made it a sacred cantata. And he had to have a cantata written for every Sunday. That means with the orchestra or just a small ensemble, depending. He had a boys' school where he had the singers. Sometimes the boys were sick, and so he had to make a really simple part for the boys. And we've seen that sometimes, because of the watermarks on papers, we can tell that he received a paper on Friday night and the cantata was performed that Sunday. So he had, I think, 23 children. And just think about practicing the organ in those days, because he wrote a lot of organ music too. And you couldn't practice the organ by yourself in those days. You had to have somebody come along and pump the bellows. And I just imagine his kids did a lot of bellow pumping for him. So this next piece is from his Magnificat, and this is the movement quia respexit, and that is the part of the Magnificat that says, for he has looked with favor upon his lowly servant. From this day, all generations will call me blessed. And this is a piece, it's an obbligato aria, means a song with an obbligato part, which is an instrumental part that is at least as interesting as the vocal part. And it's a whole different tune. It's like there's two different pieces happening at the same time over this wonderful bass line. And this is a little bit of text painting because she's singing about her lowliness, right? And then from this day, all generations will call me blessed. And when all generations happens, the choir jumps in and starts singing omnes, 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 generationes, as if the generations are now unfolding down through time. The Latin syntax is different than ours, so she's actually singing, from this day, blessed me will be called by all generations. So the omnes generationes comes at the end. It's a beautiful, beautiful piece, one of my favorites. That's all I can say about that piece. But Bach, what do you can say? What can you say about Bach? But Bach, right? Well, moving along, into the classical period, because Bach was the end of the Baroque. Moving on to the classical period, we have Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, who was a child prodigy. I had a nightmare once that he joined my children's choir. This kid was writing symphonies at the age of 9. Symphonies. Anyway, this is a time we have operas, we have symphonies, we have chamber music, and he wrote it all. Masses for big occasions. I mean, you wouldn't hear his masses at your regular little parish because it required an orchestra and soloists and a choir that could sing all of that stuff. And remember, in those days, still the boys were singing the soprano parts in the choirs. So this next piece is from Mozart's, his Alleluia from Exultate Jubilate. And you see opera is knocking at the door of the church. And this is sung by a boy soprano from Norway who is now grown up and a lovely baritone.
Axel Rykvin.
Wow. Again, wow, wow, wow. Well, we can't talk about the classical period without talking about Beethoven. And Beethoven didn't write much sacred music, except you can see he's holding a manuscript there that says Missa Solemnis, which was a huge, huge piece, concert piece with orchestra and chorus and soloists. We're having the development of what's called bel canto singing, which is a different kind of singing. And it involves a singer has to be able to sing through and cut through an orchestra and a chorus and still be heard, just a single voice. Imagine all the voices in a big chorus, and yet the bel canto soloist has to be able to be heard through that. So it's got to have a different timbre. It's a different way of singing. It can be beautiful if you like that sort of stuff. Some people do. I sort of do sometimes. Anyway, so Beethoven wrote his great Missa Solemnis, but he also wrote some shorter masses that could have been used in liturgy, but like, again, for special occasions, this wouldn't be your regular Sunday at Mass. Masses, the settings of masses are starting to move in to the concert hall. Here is a piece from his Mass in C major. This is the Sanctus, and like everything he wrote, it's just sublime. You might need to turn up your volume, but it gets loud later. Notice there that the choir got pretty loud at all of a sudden, where pleni sunt cieli, full is heaven of your glory. That's text painting, right? Next, we are going to talk about, James is going to talk about, did I miss something? Nope, there it is.
There you go.
Go ahead, James.
Yeah, so we're now moving from the period known as the Age of Reason or the Enlightenment into the period of what's called the Romantic Era, Romanticism. And Romanticism was kind of a reaction in many ways to the highly developed rationalism and return to the classicalism of the Enlightenment and the reliance on human reason and so forth. Romanticism tended, in reaction to those things, tended to emphasize human emotions and feeling and the place of nature in the world. And it's very interesting to me that during this period of time, you know, as we move from the 18th century into the 19th century, which is the movement from the Enlightenment into the Romantic period, you then have a growing interest in the medieval period, which, as you recall, the Renaissance went back to the classical area, the Greeks and the Romans, to revive or renew Europe. But after the years of the Enlightenment, and the emphasis on rationalism, there was a movement to recover more naturalistic approaches to reality. And so there was an interest in medieval events. And so it's during this period of time that this monastery, Salem, in France, began to recover a lot of the lost music that had been suppressed or lost during the last previous several centuries. And so it's interesting, you know, you have someone like a Beethoven or a Mozart who are writing these just incredibly beautiful and complex pieces of music requiring, you know, huge orchestras and choirs. And at the same time, then you have this movement sort of very quietly in the background of these monks at Salem who are seeking to recover the original purity of Catholic worship. Remember, Diana's been talking all along about how secular music, however magnificent it is always trying to insert itself into the worship of God. And so very quietly in the background during this period, as we move from the Enlightenment into the Romantic period, you have these monks in Salem quietly going about recovering these old chants from the church fathers and from the medieval period.
And they were also studying old manuscripts to see how they compared with one another. And they sort of found the Rosetta Stone from the early manuscripts, remember, that weren't on the staff, comparing those with older manuscripts that were on the staff and saying, oh, look, this is the same tune, this is the same piece. And they kind of came up with a Rosetta Stone for what all those little squiggles meant, trying to recover, because a lot of people hadn't been singing chant. It had been kind of forgotten. So going on now.
Yeah, so now during this period, I mean, while all this other magnificent music is going on, Gregorian chant now in the beginning of the mid-19th century, is beginning to wake up.
Right. And meanwhile, in the composing world of the world, the mass has moved to the concert hall. And here we have Giuseppe Verdi, who wrote a few sacred pieces that were a cappella, more of what we would recognize as sacred later in his life. He wrote a lot of operas. Now we have bel canto style on steroids, because we've got to cover a huge orchestra and a huge chorus. What I'm going to play for you now is a piece from his Requiem, the Verdi Requiem, big orchestra, big chorus. This is an old recording. This is from 1980, and I'm going to play it well, you'll see. This has Zubin Mehta conducting. It has Placido Domingo tenor, Montserrat Caballé, who is just the most wonderful soprano you've ever heard.
And if I just might add, you know, this Romantic period really stresses the emotions, the human emotions, and this is really evident in this piece.
Right, emotions on steroids too, right. Jackie Kennedy Onassis is in the audience, and you might recognize a young soprano graduate student in the first row.
Thank you.
there was a woman in the chorus who didn't have a crush. Did you catch that person? Okay. Well, next week, 20th and 21st centuries. Oh my gosh, is there a lot to talk about next time? We're going to do our best to get through it. And your quiz for next week is, who first coined the term active participation and what did it mean? So now we'll take some Q&A. And Mike, would you please launch poll number 2? Before we finish, though, I just want to say that when we play the credits, I'll play the Verdi's Ave Maria, a piece that he wrote later in his life, much quieter than the Requiem. And at the end, there might be a little surprise, too, after the discography. Besides, if you have trouble getting the discography, writing it all down fast, you can take a screenshot. I don't know how it works on a PC, but on a Mac, it's Command-Shift-4, and then you just drag it over what you want to copy, and then you've got that screenshot. It'll also be up on the website. Keep in mind that webinar number 1 is already up on the website under webinars, and number 2 is coming very soon. So questions, let's see what we've got here. I'm not sure I'll be able to answer all of them. Looks like somebody answered. Okay, Sagrada Familia in Barcelona has a split choir. Are there other churches being built nowadays with split choir? And are split choirs being utilized in churches nowadays that have split choir? Wow, I don't know. I suppose so, I hope so. Someone asked, is it allowed to play music at the elevation of the EF Mass today? I'm not sure about that. I could ask a priest and get back to you on that next week, though. And someone said, why does Latin allow you to put omnes generationes at the end of the sentence and the sentence still makes sense? Because different languages have the order of their sentences in different places. In Spanish, you would say the blue ball, it would be the ball blue. And in Germany, you would put the verb pretty much at the end of the sentence. And in Latin, I think you put the subject. But all generations will call me blessed. Who would call me blessed? All generations. So.
Yeah, I think in English, the main idea or the noun is modified by the word prior to it, like blue sky. Whereas in Latin and the Romance languages, like Spanish, for example, mesa verde, you know, it's the table green, or padre nuestro, you know, father our, same thing in Latin, pater noster. So in Latin and the Romance languages, the main idea or the noun comes first because it's the most important. And then it's modified by these either another word like Pater Noster or an idea. In the case of the Magnificat, the main idea in the Magnificat is, of course, Our Lady. The Omnes Gentes, you know, they modify her, you know, in the way of ideas. So I hope that makes sense.
Okay. The music in the Baroque and classical period seems way more epic. Do you think that has anything to do with theological infighting between Protestants and Catholics? James, what do you think?
I don't know. That's a good question. I saw that question and I thought, gee, I don't know. It may have had something to do with it. I think there was a little bit of competition going on between, you know, as the Protestants had separated themselves from Rome, each group sought to outdo the other in terms of its artistic majesty in what it could produce. So I think there may have been a little bit of that. But as far as the epic nature of some of this music, I think one of the things to remember is that Europe during that period of time had also been racked by just tremendously vicious wars, the famous 30 Years' War, which tore Europe apart, which of course would have an epic nature to it. And that may be reflected in some of this music, like that piece we heard from Verdi, which is, you know, monumentally epic. Maybe a way for the culture to kind of express emotionally what it had been through in these previous centuries. So, but that's just a guess on my part. I don't know. It's a good question.
Okay, well, that brings us to an end tonight. I'm going to leave you with the credits and the discography playing Verdi's Ave Maria. Thank you for coming. Please come next week. Tell all your friends. And if they've missed some, they'll be able to find these up on our website. Thank you so much.